It is an infinitely lonely place, this graveyard of the men who came for gold. Jack London caught it in a sentence. On the evening of the sixth day, God just tipped his barrow sideways, and thus was born Alaska. Years on from the gold rush, the descendants of its hardiest heroes are still running, the Huskies. Each year, they throw themselves into the last great race on Earth. Averaging 5,000 strides to the mile, they cross Alaska in the depth of winter to the point where America is separated from the Soviet Union by only 31 miles of pack ice and suspicion. They follow the Iditarod Trail, 1,141 miles of snow, mountain ranges, wild animals, the creaking joints of ghost towns, and temperatures below the comprehension of urban man. They end in Nome, 15, 20, 30 days after setting out from Anchorage, a town known only to oilmen and transit passengers on the polar jets.
One, two, three.
Well, it's hard, and it's hard, and it's hard.
Winter, Anchorage is host to some of the world's most remarkable adventurers. Sled dog drivers like Susan Butcher, 23 and racing for the second time. Joe Reddington is 61 and a legend. Among the 55 starters going into the draw is Rick Mackey, son of last year's winner.
Joe Reddington Sr., father of the Iditarod, drew number 10. One of the two women running in this race. Patty, what number did you draw?
43.
You're kind of getting toward the back end for a starter, aren't you?
Yeah.
Would you have rather got up further toward the front?
I would have, but things will change.
They'll change, that's right.
What will not change throughout the ordeal is constant medical supervision. Not for the drivers, since much of America shares Britain's indifference for the human species, but for the dogs.
How many miles you got on most of these dogs?
Oh, close to 1,000.
Good. We have the authority to pull any of these dogs that we see that are obviously sick or have some kind of a problem here. We can scratch them here rather than having them taken on the trail and to be pulled down the trail somewhere else. It's a pretty tough event. They're going almost 1,100 miles. Some of these mushers are averaging 70 to 80 miles a day. They're running 12, 14, 16 hours a day. Probably the most common problem we see is cut feet, irritated feet. Probably second past that would be diarrhea and dehydration.
The Huskies seem quite capable of taking care of themselves. It's their drivers, the mushers, who are worn by last year's winner, Dick Mackey.
And as far as I'm concerned, I got just one more thing to say, and that's stressing once again, take it easy on the trail and don't get hurt. We don't want anybody out there smashing up themselves or anything else. Most of you, I don't think, have any idea of how hard that is out there. It's like a piece of iron. Up in the pass itself is nothing but windblown chops, tough on sled runners, dogs and drivers alike. Watch out for all the moose. There's a lot of moose out there. Leaving Anchorage, start at Mulcahy Ballpark at 10 o'clock in the morning. We leave at 2-minute intervals, the same as we always have.
56 starts on this end. Just find your number on the fence and pick her up.
There's nothing to compare with the start of an Iditarod race. Pulling out of Anchorage, which 55 mushers and 800 dogs are about to do, is like sliding off the edge of the globe. If you're not nervous, you're a fool. The dangers around you here have a new dimension. There is surface ice out there through which you can fall and be dead in 5 minutes. There are many nights when you must sleep in the open, in temperatures which have been known to fall 100 degrees below freezing. There are wolves and moose whose prerogative it is to kill you or your dogs. It's wise to be armed.
Hand me the 38, will you, Mike? Thank you.
Yeah,
no. Hope I got enough shells. We got a lot of moose on the trail this year. So.
For the stars, race tactics vary. Emmett Peters, an Athabascan Indian.
Well, I think every musher has their own strategy. I'd rather be in the back stretch to middle part of the race, you know, as far as team-wise. I don't want to take a commanding lead or anything like that.
Like Peters, Rick Swenson, of Swedish descent, is another ex-winner.
Well, you want to stay in the front, you know, in the front bunch, and pretty much you want to save your dogs as much as possible, of course. You don't want to break any more trail than you have to, but it's only fair that you break some, you know. You can't expect one guy to do it all.
The Iditarod is to Alaskans what the Tour de France is to the French. There's the chaos inseparable from any big sporting event. Only here, your life can depend on leaving nothing behind.
Two sets of booties per dog.
Here.
How many dogs?
Oh, I got 14.
Okay.
Even the Huskies, whose nobility owes little to the pedigree book, feel the tension.
I don't get near the dogs because I know I'm going to convey that nervousness to them that I have. And you can try to control it, but you don't. You're just uptight. And so once the dogs are all harnessed up and it's ready to go up to the starting line, then I'll step in.
I feel like at this point the dogs are as ready as they're going to be. They've gone 2,000 miles in training. I'm as ready as I'm going to be. I mean, I'm sure there are other things we could do, but there's no time for those.
Five.
Huskies have no unions. Uncomplainingly, they give you the lot. Early on, their power is such that a passenger has to ride on the sled as human ballast.
Vivi, just drop the line down.
Fine. Now.
Make sure Hoodoo's on this side. All right, Johnny, switch over.
Five, four, three, line up. Two, one, go.
Go.
You're going for your second championship this time, aren't you, Rick?
You bet. I don't know. I just hope I can do it. The dog's the best I've ever had.
Well, we wish you lots of luck, Rick. And you've got 1 minute till starting time. I'm not going to bother you while you're lining up your dog team. And lots of luck to you, Rick Swenson. From Eureka. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Rick Swenson, move it out. Our next dog team up will be Joe Reddington Sr. from Smith. 20 seconds, Joe.
For Joe Reddington, there's always the kind of send-off that the British reserve for royalty. Seconds. Among other things, Reddington actually founded the Iditarod race.
10 seconds, Joe.
You got enough, Joe!
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go! Joe Reddington Sr. All from Normanton. Our next musher up to the starting line will be Jerry Riley.
The main problem is getting out of time. It really scares most drivers half to death because you're competing with teams that you don't know their capabilities and how their dogs are going to interfere with yours, and you got all the traffic and the crowds, and the dogs are going full blast. It's very difficult to slow them down to a pace that you would like them to slow down so that they won't get hurt.
For the families and friends who come to say goodbye, it's not quite the same as sending a man off on a golfing vacation. Frozen, merely standing by their cars, they can only wonder what lures men from the comforts of their homes into alien country and menacing weather. Why do they do it? Jack London, never a man to use a thousand words where five would do, diagnosed it as the call of the wild. With a face as rugged as a relief map of Alaska itself, Joe Reddington answered that call as long ago as World War II. Then he was up here mushing out dog teams to rescue American Air Force pilots who crashed in the snow while ferrying warplanes to, of all places, Moscow.
Well, I'd always read a lot of Jack London's stories about Alaska, and I've wanted to come to Alaska for many years before I came. So right after the war, I packed up and brought seven dogs with me and came to Alaska. I can remember when every house in the villages had a dog team behind them, and they grew up with the kids, and they're just practically part of the family. And even on the Iditarod, we eat with them, we sleep with them, and we love them very dearly. And without the Husky, we couldn't do anything. They're one of the kindest and nicest dogs there is. They're a very poor watchdog. They probably with 150 dogs that we got here, there might not be one even bark if you come in at night. They'd be glad to see you. And they love people, and they love to work. They love to go.
Susan Butcher's dogs are always pleased to see Susan Butcher. But what's the daughter of a rich industrialist doing here?
I like being outside. I can't stand being inside. And so that's a lot of it. Then I like animals. That's the main thing. I've worked with animals since I was half a day old. That's been my whole life. And particularly dogs. And I just love my dogs. If I'm not running them, I'm out here playing with them, playing with the puppies. And so it just suits me perfect to be outside. The Iditarod gives you country. You've got all the way from here to Nome to see, and it's beautiful, and there's caribou and moose out there and everything, and so it's all very enjoyable. This is my lead dog, Tekla, and I got her when she was a little puppy, and she was a natural-born leader. I started her in lead the first time she ever went in harness when she was 4 months old, and I lived out in the bush then where I had to haul all my own wood and water, and I had three sleds, one water sled, one wood sled, and one training sled, and I never had to say a word to her. If I put the wood sled behind her, she'd go straight to the wood pile, and if I put the water sled behind her, she'd go to the water hole, and then if I put the training sled, she'd go off down the trail. So she's just real natural. At 2 years old, she went all the way from Anchorage to Nome in single lead, and which is a lot of pressure on a dog.
Back on the Iditarod Trail, 24 hours have elapsed and the leaders have reached Squint. Population hardly big enough to hold an argument. The Husky, who could eat a Pekingese as casually as an after-eight mint, can sleep through anything. Alaska is the land of the two-plane family. The airspace over the early checkpoints of the trail is always crowded to see the leaders pull in. But from here, the sightseers will fly home and leave the trail to the professional bush pilots.
To get some water into my dogs. I overfed them a little bit last night, and I've got a little diarrhea in the team, so I'm going to try to water them. It is interesting that a dog on this race won't drink clear water. He'll drink overflow, or he'll drink sweetened or flavored water. But just plain water, very seldom will he drink.
All trails fine. Much better than it was last year.
Here, only Baumgartner hits trouble.
In lean dogs?
Yeah, I think so.
You gonna leave some?
Gonna drop two.
Two?
Yeah. Maybe. Day? Maybe. I may, no, definitely I'm gonna drop one. I might have to drop two.
Okay.
Lake Lucille, when we took off there, that wind was blowing awful bad. And the dogs the grip of their toenails. Well, you cut them off so they don't get ripped off. You know, you trim them. But occasionally, like him, he's gripping so hard, he might get caught in a little ice crevice or something and bust it back a little bit, just like you getting your fingernail ripped. And so it, you know, can be a little sore.
Unfortunately, it is lead dog Vodka, navigator and driving force, who's the trouble.
Well, as long as he keeps going, it's okay. If it turns into a problem, it's a real setback. Because there's your team right there. The rest of them supply the power, but they won't go unless he's there. And he sets the speed, the pace, and everything.
Without the planes, the Iditarod race couldn't happen. Bush pilots like Larry Thompson are there to airlift sick or injured dogs back to Anchorage, to drop food into remote places, to effect the occasional rescue.
Well, it's the only way we're going to get out in these areas is either dog team or aircraft. And there's been cases where snow machines have tried to keep up with the dogs and couldn't do it. And so that's the only way we can cover the trail is by air. There are no roads. Well, I've had as high as 23 dogs in the airplane. Where we had to get in at a given evening, getting dark, couldn't make another trip. But ordinarily, we carry around a dozen or 15 dogs to a load.
In awesome desolation lie the bones of the adventurers, the panhandlers, the fortune hunters, the thieves, who attempted to fight their way through God's afterthought to the golden Yukon at the turn of the century. But the Iditarod is only in part a commemoration of their endurance. It's also a celebration of the pioneering spirit that remains fiercely alive in the people of Alaska.
The actual running of the race, I'd like to think, perpetuates an Alaskan way of life and relates to a way of life that you perhaps wish you were born 100 years ago and could have been a part of it. And the Iditarod makes you a part of it.
Pretty good.
Checkpoint Finger Lake. 2 days, 194 miles gone. Yet, though cold for humans, it's still not cold enough for the dogs, who prefer it around 50 below freezing. It's their last rest before they haul Rick Mackey up into the Alaska range.
They go a lot better at night. Like last night, I was flat moving. It's just they overheat. You make worse time, and it takes more out of the dogs. They get dehydrated quicker. It's and they rest better in the sun, so it's good when it's, you know, find you a nice sunny spot and just camp for about 4 hours and let them soak up the sunshine and move out after dark. It's a lot harder on the musher after dark. Like, I got hit in the eye last night with a dang stick. It felt like it poked my eye out, but I don't like to keep my headlight on too much because then if there's another guy coming up behind you or something, he knows right where you're at. He can follow you. In fact, I was doing that to another guy last night. He kept his on. He didn't even know I was there.
I got one female, young dog, that's, she came in heat just a little before the race, and every time my team stops, they turn right around, come right back. I end up with some really fine tangles out there.
Hello, yours is there. I make it up out of a ground meat and honey and a lot of vitamins and eggs. And I just snack them. That's fed cold. And then I'm going to move on down the trail a ways before I go ahead and feed them if they're mixed feed.
Most stays here will be brief. In the lone log cabins along the trail, visitors are about as frequent as Father Christmas. So they lavish you with kindness, talk, and food.
Geez, that does look good.
Yeah.
What's in it, anyway?
Oh, macaroni. Just about everything. How are you doing,
Susan? It's not difficult, as the temperatures plunge outside, to succumb to the blandishments of home cooking in a bed. Despite the fierce competition, there is among mushers a strong camaraderie born of danger shared.
It seems like I'm not getting as much sleep as would be nice. There's not much time after the dogs eat. It seems like they're cared for.
You get very tired of especially the wind and the cold, but you can tolerate that. But then when you have to get into the sled and sleep at night and get up in it and still be in it the next morning, it wears you down. You wear down physically, but I think you wear down mentally more than anything else.
No. Come on now. Gee. All right. No. Get up there. All right. Gee. You know where the trail's at.
So far this year, conditions are hardly more severe than a European winter, which has given the race a very fast start. But Rainy Pass lies ahead, an absurdly inappropriate name for a geological fault that slashes through the towering Alaska Range. In past races, it has proved a blizzard-swept wind tunnel which compelled men and dogs to dig in and sit it out. Others have become hopelessly lost. Right through the pass, the weather holds. But there's not a musher unaware of the story of Norman Vaughan. Vaughan served his apprenticeship with sled dogs on Admiral Byrd's 1928 expedition to Antarctica. 3 years ago, age 72, he took part in the Iditarod. About here, in blinding snow, he took a wrong turning. A search party found him just in time, 5 days later. His starving dogs had eaten their harness. Vaughan was in the late stages of hypothermia.
Thank you.
After the long, plodding haul of the Alaska Range, many choose to rest here, Roan River, set in the high north of the imagination. Each team, by competition rules, is required to pull off the trail at some point of their journey for a complete 24-hour break to refresh their dogs.
Guys like little babies, you know, sometimes they don't. If you get them in a big hunk, they won't eat it. They're tired. You notice some people are taking their 24-hour layover here. It's probably a good idea. I'm gonna go to McGrath.
Have the dogs and you're always thinking and maybe even talking to the dogs or you're concentrating so much so that you don't really get lonely. You find yourself feeling that you're very small in such a huge area. You can go up a mountain canyon and you know, you're nothing. You're just a speck compared to those mountains. And then you have a sense of loneliness, but I think it's more a sense of smallness. You don't amount to anything compared to that land.
Six days gone. The big city of the trail, McGrath. It has a teeming population of 500, a store in which you can buy a chainsaw or an engagement ring, a heart as big as Eskimo Nell's, a prodigious thirst, and McGuire's, one of the epic bars of the world. It is, in fact, the last place for 700 miles where a man may legally buy a drink. The more gregarious of the mushers tend to choose McGrath or McGuire's for their 24-hour rest. The odd refreshment in McGuire's, where opening hours are measured in months, has contributed considerably to Iditarod trail lore. One man openly admits he lost two races right here.
I can't remember, you know. I've been trying to remember how I felt last year by the time I got to McGrath, and I don't remember at all. Well, so I don't know if I'm more tired or less tired or what.
Well, I came over and woke you up this evening, and you'd put a sawmill to shame. I mean, you were really getting after it there.
Yeah, I know. I'm a little bit tired.
Up until now, it hasn't been too much of a concern. When you leave here, you kind of want to know where the next driver is and how long since he left McGrath and if he's had his 24 and the whole bit, right?
Very, very true. We've just been checking on a lot of that right now and who to watch, and you can get a lot of good information here at McGrath.
Information, in that context, means getting the lowdown on opponent's strategy. Among the front runners, there's a great deal of chicanery. Some just put down their glasses and slip out of town to catch their opponents napping. For Rick Mackey, there are too many problems for sleep.
I don't know. I've got some good dogs, but they won't eat. They're not doing too good. I've tried everything. Seal meat, beaver meat, horse meat, even pancakes. I don't know what it is. A lot of guys are having trouble this year. I'm going to have the vet take a look at them and give them a shot of B-complex.
Veterinary supervision of the race is intense, not only for the obvious reasons, but to counter the criticism of some animal lovers who see the race as cruel.
A lot of the dogs that are low on fluids, if perhaps they have diarrhea, they're losing a lot of water-soluble vitamins. B complex is one of that group, and we try and replace it. Also, B12 is an appetite and thirst stimulator to a certain extent.
Scenes like this may not entirely allay certain suspicions, but it's fact that no dog is pushed beyond its limits.
I suppose there are some that would object. Anything that we're doing here is based on a medical or a physiological principle. I suppose that the question that might be raised is whether or not the dog is being pushed too hard if this needs to be done. In this case, this particular team, I don't think that's the case. The dog's had the misfortune to get ill, and we're trying to help him a little bit.
I'm not too far behind yet. I've just been trying to hold up there close enough so when I do get the dogs going, I can catch right up. But if you lose a few hours each day, it's gonna hurt. In another week or so, I'll be way behind. I know that.
It's here that newcomers begin to understand the immensity of the race. As they leave McGrath, they're still not halfway. 445 miles gone, 696 to go. And now, unprotected by the Alaska range as they head for Iditarod, a constant wind produces a chill factor that drags the temperatures still lower. Iditarod in the year 1907. The town, now commemorated by the Last Grate Race on Earth, was then populated by 3,000 desperate men who came on the rumor that this was El Dorado. But the gold ran out. Some left, some died, and their town died with them. Today, Iditarod has a population of 6. A trapper and his family. But it briefly increases when the race comes through. Officials set up their tents to check on the halfway placings. The first man in is Joe May. May's been leading all the way from Anchorage and arrives with a very good question.
What day of the week is it?
Saturday.
I lost one somewhere, I think.
What's your number?
Who?
Glad to have you in, Joe.
It's good to be here.
I'll bet
it's nasty up there behind me. It was getting nasty coming down.
KL7 JDH, KL7 IZL.
KL7 IZL, KL7 JDH, go ahead.
Okay, Tom, we're still reporting Joe May in at 1422, the first musher in, and we have nobody else having shown yet. We're still looking and expecting somebody momentarily. Joe is incidentally, and I don't know if you did copy, spending the night here at Iditarod, planning to spend the night. You got it?
Oh, the trail was a little hard to find in places, but not too bad. This is my first time I've been through here, and you stop breathing when you lose the trail, and then you start breathing again when you find it.
Well, you don't sleep out last night by choice. You sleep out because you have to, but I mean, it's just, I don't know, Emmett and I were talking about it. There's nothing else to do in this time of the year. You know, what else is there to do? I mean, it's just we've gotten so much, it's part of our life. You know, and what else would you, it's just like you're used to going on holiday in August or something. Well, people in Alaska are crazy anyways.
Is that water, that tubing? Yeah, it sure helped. That one little dog that we did it to, I used her in lead all day yesterday. She felt so dang good, boy, she just wanted to go, go, go. It's a good way to get water in them.
We went 135 miles in, really without any real rest. I've got one dog that came 40 miles on just 3 legs. She injured a ligament, and so I'm going to be dropping her here, but she ran the whole way, still pulling in harness.
Well, it was pretty cold. It was probably as much as 45 degrees below the freezing point, and with the wind blowing like it was, we had probably 30-mile wind at times. Well, it'd be as much as maybe 75 below the wind factor. It's awful cold on hands when you take your mittens off to, like, to boot the dogs.
Any musher is only as good as the feet of his dogs. And with vicious winds now scouring the snow off some points of the trail, a husky's feet need protection.
Well, I want to keep these guys as happy as I can. And their feet get sore. They get cut up by the ice sometimes. And when they get sore feet, they just don't feel so good. And they don't want to go anywhere. I know how they feel. I got a sore foot, too, from these boots I'm wearing.
We got a steady breeze, but it ain't so bad compared to years in the past when we hit that 90-mile show factor below zero and hung up a couple of days because of snow problem. No trails. Well, we got a nice weather, I think. I don't know what the other mushers think.
A thousand times in the race that you wish a helicopter could come and just pluck you out and get you out of there, you know, and the thought goes through your mind, what am I doing here?
Anvik brings out the children, for whom this week's school is an afterthought, to welcome each musher in turn. But for hours on end, the bell fails to toll. For by here, on the banks of the Yukon, 630 miles from the start, 500 from the finish, the gaps between the teams are ever lengthening. The spread of the field between front runners and back markers after 10 days is now 250 miles. Some are 5 days behind. Three of the 55 teams have dropped out. Rick Swenson, as promised, as always, is up with the leaders.
Bad feet, maybe?
Well, this one here pulls so hard, her feet go to hell on her own.
At any point in the race, the real stars are these, each half a hundredweight of loyalty and unquestioning bravery. Patty Friend leaves Anvik rather she arrived here, mildly out of control. She's 2 days behind.
Last night, I left the checkpoint at 3 o'clock in the morning, hoping to get a nice early start, and I and about four other people were lost until 6:30, and we just kept circling round and round and round, and that's really hard on the dogs, too, because it was deep snow. If I'm going to be anywhere near the front, I had better fly right now.
And so to the Yukon, a mile-wide giant paralyzed by ice. This haul stretches 130 flat miles due north between its banks. Dogs have fallen asleep here as they ran, and strange, inexplicable visions have come to men too exhausted to remember the word hallucination. The Bering Sea, this year remarkably unfrozen.
Okay, I got 7:50. 10 minutes to eight.
Woo! 7 minutes to eight.
From Unalakleet, round the rim of the Norton Sound, it's a 217-mile sprint to the finish. If you're not up with the leaders now, you have no chance.
Don, the big question, how long are you going to stay?
2 hours.
2 hours.
Don Honey is telling a lie. Now everyone lies about his next intention.
Emmett! Hell, it's Emmett!
Emmett Peters, a laconic but fierce contender. His winning time 4 years ago, just under 14 days and 15 hours, is still the all-time record.
Come here.
But this year, he's not getting away. Sonny Lindner is right behind.
Yeah, except for this last part.
Yeah, how's your dogs doing?
Good.
Holding up all right, huh?
Yeah.
Good. Big question, how long are you going to stay? That's the answer.
7:48.
Okay.
7:50.
Good.
Lindner gives nothing away. The next man in is remarkable. In 1977, he won. In 1978, after 1,100 miles, he lost by exactly 1 second. The hardest man in the race, Rick Swenson.
Welcome. All right, get up, buddy. All
right, get up. Yeah, let's see. You're an hour and 48 minutes behind Honey and Emmett and Linder. That's the order they came in. 1, 2, 3, right behind each other.
Honey, Emmett, and Linder, or Emmett, Honey, and Linder?
No, Honey, Emmett, and Linder. Uh-huh. Hour and 50 minutes ago.
That's about right.
Next day, with 165 miles to go, the lead has changed. It's now Sonny Lindner ahead at the Eskimo whaling station at Shektulik. Here, the average weather forecast sounds like science fiction. The wind sweeps straight in from Siberia. At 40 miles an hour, it produces a chill factor that turns minus 50 into an effective Fahrenheit temperature of 120 below. A man can lose his ears here simply by taking his hat off.
Hi, welcome to Shektulik. 1128.
Yes. Okay, how long are you going to stay, Sonny?
Oh, 5 or 6 hours.
Yeah. Did you see anybody behind you from the mountains?
No.
Because you and Don left together, I guess, 4 o'clock this morning?
Well, sort of. We left about the same time, but I didn't see him.
Yeah, okay. Swenson was just coming up the ridge, on that long last ridge, so he's at least an hour and a half behind you.
Uh-huh.
Did you have any problems on the trail?
No. Just finding the way out of Unalakleet, you know, through the dump and all, but...
Yeah, how are the dogs? Good shape?
Yeah. Seemed to be. They did all right till we got down here in the wind.
Yeah, you're not going to drop any?
No.
No, good. Okay, well, get them out of the wind and get some rest, huh? Okay. Can you tell if that's Emmett or Swenson in the lead for sure?
That's Emmett.
Emmett's in the lead. Swenson's right behind. And then there's a third team way down there. So that's Emmett, all right. Swenson right on his tail. Linder's just about... got in here about 2 hours ago.
He did? What time did you leave? 4?
Yeah, but where's Honey?
He's right behind us.
Well, where's Riley then? He left same time you guys, huh?
Yeah, he's behind us.
Oh, he's behind you?
Yeah, I'll go there.
Oh, okay. You dropped 2 dogs at Unalakleet, huh?
Yeah.
Well, why?
One was crippled up and the other one wasn't pulling, and with this bum leg, I don't want to haul nothing.
Yeah, right.
Because I'm riding now. I ain't letting nobody else ride.
You got about 2 hours behind Linder. That doesn't bother you too much?
Well, he snuck out of town. That's the way it goes. I'm glad I got out of there when I did.
Yeah.
Lindner gambles his 2-hour lead on sleep, but it costs him dearly. In the chaos outside, the weather blots out humanity.
Thank you.
It's in this weather that the front runners make their break. Lindner loses his lead, Pony loses his way and has to sit out the night in a snow cave. It's left to Peters and Swenson to fight it out. Front Street, no. The end of a dog race further than from London to Rome. Nome's population has doubled from 3,000 to 6 as people fly in for a finish that will command headlines across the width of Alaska. The answer is coming out of the night. Swenson, the hard man, in 15 days, 10 hours, 37 minutes, 47 seconds. The first man to win twice.
47 seconds. 1979, Iditarod champion.
Well, it was the best Iditarod race I've been in. It was the best weather. We had the best trail conditions. And I didn't have any trouble, and I'd like to mention this, that these little storms at the end kind of once again proved the point that you can't monkey around. If you want to win, you better be up front.
Rick Swenson is 28. At university, he claims he read Gin and Women. He won £6,000. Susan Butcher, the first woman home, came ninth and got next to nothing. But the Iditarod Trail is no longer about gold or even winning. It's about surviving and reaching the end of the loneliest road. It was 9 days later when the very last man came in from the cold.